Even my counterparts that had been in a self-operated component of the building for years would look at what we were doing and say, God, why does Food and Beverage get to do those things? And the truth was, we were never not willing to ask.
Hey there, ALSD, Jared Frank back in Fort Worth today at the Dickies Arena with Julie Margolin, Director of Food and Beverage. Julie, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having us.
You know, there's many different arteries we could take this conversation down because it's just a phenomenal story to tell, but I think it's worth starting with the fact that your food and beverage is an in-house operation, and I'm curious what some of the benefits and advantages of that aspect are.
You know, it's amazing. The opportunity to be self-operated really gives you so much more flexibility. You get to become really intimate with the community, with the building, and you get to customize everything that you're doing, not just for that community in general on an annual basis, but we have the mobility and the flexibility to really do it on an event-by-event basis. We can shift concepts, we can shift offerings, we can shift elements of the building or the design to really suit what best is going on with inside it. What guests we're going to be attending to, what staff are getting excited about and hearing, we get that feedback and we can react. And I think that's probably my favorite element about being in a self-operated building is just we have the ability to access and tap into what feels good and then execute on it right away. And if we hit a vein that doesn't feel so good, or we think it's great, and then all of a sudden in practice it doesn't execute at the level we were hoping, or it's not getting the kind of response we wanted, all of a sudden we don't have to wait an extended period of time to make a change. We can make that change in event, next event. We can move so quickly to really hone in and tweak to really what makes the most sense. That kind of flexibility, that kind of control is incredible. And it's right at the venue level.
Do you have previous experience with running and directing an in-house operation like this?
I do, in fact. I've been very fortunate in my career. I actually started in the sports entertainment industry with a third-party company, wonderful group to work with, and really it was amazing to understand that model, which is truly very common, especially when you're dealing with NBA, NHL large-scale venues. And there's a lot of incredible things that come with being in a third-party operated platform. Your focus is only on food and beverage, essentially. Their focus as a corporation, as a company, is to ensure the food and beverage experience is exactly what it is envisioned to be. And that vision originates at a corporate level and it gets passed into its operators, who then get a limited amount of ability to adjust it to the community, but really are entrusted to execute that vision and some of those core components and make sure that those play well in the market and the building they're in. And so I had that experience both in Los Angeles, California. I actually started out at the Staples Center, overseeing their premium operations, and then was lucky enough to move into the overall director responsibility there for both the Staples Center and at that time the Nokia Theater at LA Live, which we had recently opened. And so being in that environment, getting some exposure to certainly big markets and big buildings, lots of teams, lots of players helping to drive and engage in what the community-based offering was. But then also coming from a corporate culture that was Levy Restaurants out of Chicago, great vision, great company, supporting that process throughout. And with them, I got the ability to learn a lot about it. I was with Staples for roughly 6 years in that third-party environment, and then was tapped to actually move to Brooklyn, New York, back to New York, where I'm originally from. And I was lucky enough to be the director of operations that opened the Barclays Center there. And that was also the third-party element. Mm-hmm. So got the opportunity to be in that capacity there, sort of work from that third-party model to open a venue. And then it was while I was at the Barclays Center that I was tapped to go back to the West Coast. I keep traversing the country a little bit and actually got my first foray into self-operated food and beverage. The Honda Center at that time was looking to make a change and take their food and beverage in-house after about 20 years of being in a third-party relationship. And so it was an interesting question. It was a great opportunity to understand what I had learned from that third-party model, what I'd seen, what I liked, and, you know, quite frankly, what I felt in a self-operated world could be improved on, and got the chance to actually do that in creating that self-operated company with inside the Honda Center experience out there.
Were there one or two lessons learned from your experience at the Honda Center that are informing your decisions here at this new arena?
Absolutely. I mean, I think the best thing about this industry is when you learn every day. we never live the same day twice. And, you know, the opportunity to continue to grow as a person, as an operator, as a professional continues to be there. So those lessons are learned every day. When Matt and I actually first started talking, it was about, help me understand the difference between third party and self-operated, and what are some of the strengths, what are some of the challenges, just as he was considering which way he wanted to pursue for Dickies. And when we started talking about it, some of the biggest things I said, listen, we've learned because we've made big mistakes, you know, and there's only opportunities to learn from those mistakes to get better. And we did that in those first few years of being self-operated. And some of the biggest ones are, you know, learn your market, learn your people, and recognize that some of the things that will work, you know, and I was fortunate, I had been in the LA market. I thought I knew what the LA fan wanted. I spent 6 years, I had run the premium, then I had taken over the whole building and then a concert venue. It's like, we've got this, we know. And then the circus rolled into town in Orange County. And we, you know, set ourselves up from a production standpoint, from an operational standpoint, all with that same, this is the LA fan market, this is the California market. Oh boy, were we wrong. We hadn't seen it. The Orange County market was completely different than LA, even for something as simple and simple and similar as the circus. Not to suggest the circuses were simple, because they definitely aren't. But with that reality, it was one of those, wow, you have to trust that the experience you've had is going to help you, but you can't rest on those laurels. You need to do your homework. You need to be willing to experience it all for the first time and tweak and adjust very specific to where you are. And the benefit of being self-operated is we had that ability. So from those first few performances of thinking we knew better or knew what to expect, and then realizing, oh boy, we don't, we need to react quickly, we could. And I think that was one of the biggest learnings early on, was that not everything is cookie cutter. And some of the things that you've had to keep very consistent in those previous models or previous experiences, when you don't have to keep them and you start thinking outside the box for every event and every group that might be coming in your venue, all of a sudden you reap such great rewards and you start to see a deeper, different connection with your guest, but you also see so much more creativity and so much more inspiration from your team. And that was really one of the biggest wins, was recognizing that best in the industry is great and everybody's got to have experience to do what we do at a level that we want to thrive in, but don't just tap into one person for one thing. There's so much more. Talk about it, brainstorm, see what's going on, throw things against the wall that are absolutely insane, that might cost more than you ever thought could be reasonable or approved, and then drill down in why they're really great ideas, and then approach. I think one of the bigger wins about it, you know, being at the Honda Center in particular, was, you know, even my counterparts that had been in a self-operated component of the building for years would look at what we were doing and say, God, why does Food and Beverage get to do those things? And the truth was, we were never not willing to ask. Where it might have in another environment felt like, that'll never get approved, so let's not waste time thinking about it. Let's not drill into it, let's not consider it. We were willing to say, okay, let's, you know, dream big. I want you to ask for the unicorn. What do we want? What could we really do? And then we would hone in on it. And sometimes those came with a lot of effort. Some of those came with big price tags. Some of them came with little of either, but just we had to work through it enough to get to how we could make it great with the effort and the energies and the passion for it. And I think being willing to not automatically think within the confines of financials or what's been previously approved or what's been previously done is why that self-op model is so exciting. Because if you kind of throw those walls of caution out, you can get some really great realities to come to the surface.
Absolutely.